Alarm dismissed.
So I'm on a quest to become a 4 a.m. girly, just so I will be able to have more time in my day, knock out tasks. And I'm doing this because I already wake up at 4 o'clock, but what happens is I plop right back down to bed, maybe because I overslept. Not overslept, but I stayed awake too long. I slept at 1, so 4 is not enough time. And I like knock myself back out to get a few more hours. And sometimes I'm just not feeling it. Like the whole point of waking up 4 o'clock in the morning, I just don't carry out. So I think I'm going to turn this into a week vlog to challenge myself to wake up 4 o'clock in the morning and do some things.
Alarm dismissed.
It is 6 o'clock and I want to explain what happened. When I woke up at 4 in the morning, I think I went back to sleep 25 minutes, then I woke up, that I just wasn't feeling it, as I said, is what happens, and I went back to sleep. I was up working at 8 as I wanted to, right? But again, did I do any tasks before then, before I got going? No, I didn't listen to my New York Times podcast. I was making breakfast while I was sending out emails. Why is this? Hold on. So something was up with the lens from last night. Making a whole mess. Oh my goodness. Well, let's wipe you down as well. I got everything done in a jumble, basically, is what I'm trying to say. And I don't want that anymore. I failed today, like I failed yesterday. We're not gonna fail tomorrow, okay? We're gonna wake up at 4 tomorrow. And the first thing I'm gonna do at 4, I'm gonna take a shower. And then after the shower, I'm going to make breakfast. And then after making breakfast, I'm going to... Shit, what am I going to do? Huh. I don't know. It's going to be constructive, but it's going to feel good, okay, when I accomplish it. Hi, so I just wanted to recount how the morning went, okay? So I woke up at 4 and... I immediately started reading, right? When I felt that visceral feeling to go back to sleep again, I took out my Kindle. My Kindle was right there, actually. I didn't take it out. I picked it up and start reading. Now, did I transition that into something? Well, you saw what I did, but it was more after 4 or 5, like around 6 or so. 6, 7, 8, I started preparing for a meeting. Blah, blah, blah. But basically, I didn't necessarily hit the goal of starting things at 4. I did try to hack into my psyche, again, picking up that Kindle and reading something that does capture my attention to stay awake. But you know, the goal is to start doing things at 4. So we're almost there, okay? We're almost there. Let's try again tomorrow. Hi, so I just wanted to recount how this morning went. I absolutely got things done. I got my emailing done early. I was able to do my laundry and also fold, put my clothes away after my laundry. I have some more laundry I have to go fetch, but I was able to do that. I have some boxes here from, you know, past Amazon orders. I've been able to cut it up and put it in a bag. Hopefully I can throw it away soon. I wasn't able to read, but I was able to email. This feels great. Now, in the beginning, it didn't feel great. I felt very, very groggy. And I'm going to admit to you, like, I was awake. I was in front of my desk at, like, 7? And I did some emails. Then I hit back to sleep, like a 5 to 15 minute nap, then I was up again. So I did like relapse back into sleep. But again, like
why. Maybe I have to sleep at 9 o'clock on the dot so I can feel energized when I wake up at 4. Maybe something else, you know? I'll figure this out. But it was a really successful day, and I can confidently say that there is some benefits to being a 4 a.m. girly.
Hello. So I did not bother to film for waking up 4 o'clock in the morning because I did not wake up 4 o'clock in the morning this Friday. Okay? I woke up, you know what I probably did, but then I went straight back to sleep. Because, you guys, I stayed up until like 1. Okay? And don't ask me what for. I don't know what I was doing that had me stay up. But I did. And yeah, I needed my sleep. And I didn't. I only got up at 7 to start working. Okay? So that was it. So we're skipping Friday. We're going to segue into something else. Okay? We're going to make my Manhattan clam chowder. And let me just say that I have a whole bunch of soups ordered, okay? And I did that because I recently got this, as you saw before. The idea that I have is to try all these fancy schmancy soups that I ordered, right? Just for the sake of having something to eat or something to make in this thingamajigger. I guess I am trying all these canned things for my taste palette. And then I'll try and make it again, right? And this is the Manhattan clam chowder that I'm gonna have. Well, hold on, let me cover it again before this messes up everything. Guys, this 4 a.m. stuff is not working out. I don't know why. So what happened was I woke up at 4. I went right back to sleep. It's Saturday, ma'am. Okay. I woke up at 7 and then I started reading. I just finished the last available book of Under the Oak Tree. Through my podcasts, right, they're advertising this book called Super Communicator. And I really want to be able to do that. So that is the next book I'm going to crack into. I also want to watch Dune. There is nobody more in this world who is excited for the Dune premiere. Maybe tonight or Sunday, I could head out there and finally see what Dennis, whatever his last name is, has in store for Dune 2, you know? I just recently Instacart some new groceries and I tried to get waffle mix, but they didn't have any. So she got this, and on the Instacart, it said it was like a combo. It can work as a pancake mix and as a waffle mix, right? But now that I have the box, where's the confirmation that it works as a waffle mix? It just says complete pancake mix. So I'm assuming the formula can still work as a waffle mix, you know? Well, I didn't mean for it to fill up the whole content. Oh no, that was not the result I was expecting. It's looking like a waffle, even though we use a pancake mix. When I want waffle-shaped pancakes for breakfast, I guess I can go in here and pull it out now, can I?
Why? And, like, so tactical, y'all. He puts her in her place. Because to be rejected by these men, nice guy, and was with a another woman. When she, well, I don't know if you saw this, but when she threatens to come out with the information that he's full of crap, I really disagree with her.
What's really cool about these pancake mixes is that you see how they said a Nutella sample inside? This is it. So that would be a pretty nice addition to this treat I'm trying to put together, you know? There you go. Yum, yum, yum.
I realize they're in a situationship. Because just because he's nice to you doesn't mean he actually wants commitment. I don't even understand what... Like, if I read this letter, I'd be like, but you wrote this years ago before you knew me. What does this have to do with me? How I feel about you goes without saying. This is the perfect double talk right here.
Alarm dismissed.
So I finally got my ticket to see Dune 2. I'm gonna head out there.
But remember this theater? We're back.
So I just got back from watching the Dune movie, which was a fantastic space opera. I love the religious elements. I like the subtlety. Basically, these are humans from centuries into the future. Like, maybe even 1,000 years from what I remember. So I think I always have fun seeing what of Earth culture lasted when we become an interplanetary species, you know? For example, Princess Irulan and her people, were they Christians? And I'm not thinking they're generally Christian, like they're parents. Religion has such an influence over fashion. You see how the Muslim faith has an influence over how they dress, fashion. And Christianity does too, right? So maybe they're not currently Christians, but do they have those roots where they have the appearance that they have, that medieval appearance? Maybe, maybe not. But I like seeing those little bits and pieces. Like in the first movie, you see the bagpipes, but you also see the facial covering, which is probably to protect from the sand, but also is that the Muslim inspired way of dress, Arabic inspired, right? And like, where are the lines between religion and just fashion for the sake of fashion? As for the plot, you enjoy the strategies they have. For example, in the history of war, you have the Vietnamese, like think of the Vietnamese War. They won because they understood the territory more than the invaders. Same thing with war in Ethiopia. The Ethiopian army is hard to beat because they understand their territory more than the invaders. Same thing with Switzerland. Same thing with, who am I thinking about? Who else? Same thing with the Native Americans in our history. To beat the Native Americans, the intruders really had to understand the ways of the Native Americans. I forgot which tribe. The indigenous American tribe that had the Mohawks, I believe, are the ones who they had to learn their ways to learn how to beat them. And you see that pattern with the freedmen, right? The freedmen, they understand the desert. So when it comes to fighting them in the desert, it's hard, right? They know how to fight. They know how to move in sand. They know how to plot ambush in sand. And they know how to control the sand creatures as a way of warfare. So I enjoy those details. I also like, I'm going to butcher this, the Bene Gerais. I always like those women. It kind of frustrates me how little... I did read the books, but I forgot all those details. And the books are kind of difficult to digest. So basically, I'm like trudging on trying to finish the books more than I am digesting the details, at least in a way where I can remember them, okay? But the Bene Gerais, if I'm saying that right, I know I'm not, are interesting. How are they able to make themselves such a huge part of this space opera's politics, where each one have them and trusts them? Of course, you know why. They're women. Female influence, feminine influence is very, very important. We have a soft power. So the Bene Gerais are masters of female soft power in how they can infiltrate, it seems, everyone's spaces and be of political importance, all while obviously having their own plot. The way they are written really captures female influence in politics. For example, without spoiling too much, there's this girl, okay, and she basically is able to seduce a powerful leader and get pregnant, and that to extend the plot of the Bene Gesserit. But I have a question. My question is, how committed are they to their plots? Like, do they always have to be so beautiful, right? Because the girl, I'm gonna butcher her name for sure, but I know it's that famous French actress, right? And she was cast to be a seductress. Understand that the character has to seduce this person. She was cast. That Jessica actress, she's very lovely. I'm casting her, and you understand how the Duke fell in love with her. So I'm always thinking, do they make sure they're genetically beautiful to have their influence, have their social currency to infiltrate what they infiltrate? I found that really, really curious. And I'm very curious about Chani. The movie kind of deviates from the books when it comes to Chani in a very, very good day, but a very, very curious way as well. Certain emotional ties in the book is not the same in the movie. I don't even want to spoil it for you. I can say this. In the book, Paul assures her that she's the main piece, okay? She's the main piece. She is the only piece despite politics. But in the movie, that reassurance doesn't happen. So it's like, how are you important? Then, like, yeah, it just ends with the expression of her heartbreak about something, and I'm wondering, well, how are you going to get tied back in, you know? And is it going to be romantic? Because you do like them together, and you don't like the idea of her just being a placeholder until I'm saying too much. But yes, it was a great movie. I had a good time. 3 hours, but I kind of wish it was longer, because I wanted to get in more detail. Also, love the Anya Taylor-Joy cameo. Will we see her in the third movie? Hopefully she signs that contract and it gets to dry properly. But yeah, love Dune. And I guess I end this vlog with thoughts of my 4 a.m. plan. I would say that I'm disappointed in myself that I really couldn't use that time I had bought myself waking up early constructively. But I am satisfied with the fact that I do, basically, I'll wake up at 4 and it's still early. I'm still capturing those early hours and doing things in those early hours before we get deeper into the day. And I do like that, at least. I have to do some introspection about why is it I feel less time scarcity when you wake up at 4 than I feel in the middle of the day. Because, you know, waking up at, let's say, 9 to the end of the day should feel like enough. I'm doing this 4 a.m. experiment because it doesn't feel like enough. And I understand ADHD and how it messes up my time management is a part of that. But what makes me think that more hours is going to give me a better sense of control is what I have to ask myself and figure out for myself. But that's the end of the experiment for this week. See you guys next week. Bye.